For most of our graduates, the building inscribed Nurses' Home was just that, a home during those intense years as they were transformed from students to nurses. To a smaller number, though not home in the literal sense, it was the place where hopes and dreams resided as students struggled to complete their nursing education. While those who now enter the school cannot add to the store of memories, they share, along with their predecessors, the pride that comes from being a Christ Hospital graduate. Some alumni, like those who gathered to celebrate our 75th anniversary in 1977, remembered a time before the building was part of our school. Before 1929, students occupied a series of buildings, some now long gone. Here began the continuing process of building something we've carried to our new building, the foundation for our reputation, the pride we all share as graduates of the Christ Hospital School of Nursing. Join us on a journey through our history to revisit your own school days and others, some earlier, some later. Caring. So much a part of who we are today, the word also describes our beginnings. In fact, caring for the poor was the initial concern that resulted in the Elizabeth Gamble Deaconess Home Association. The association, founded by a group of concerned Methodists, was determined to improve social conditions in the West End. In 1889, when Deaconess Isabella Thoburn found a cancer-stricken woman crying on the curb, caring for the sick became part of the equation. Thus was born the institution initially known as Christ's Hospital. Between 1889 and 1903, 218 deaconesses were trained to staff the hospital. Impressive as this number was, it wasn't enough. Hoping to increase the number of enrollees, the association decided that as of 1902, young women who did not wish to become deaconesses could be admitted into nurses' training. Despite this relaxation of standards, the school did not abandon its religious roots. An application from those early years posed the question, "How long have you been a Christian?" The first class selected a distinctive uniform resembling a Puritan costume. Worn by students until 1930, it was a blue chambray dress with long sleeves and full skirt, white gathered apron, white organdy cuffs, fichu, and cap. Cora Peppercorn Pandorf, class of 28, remembers getting properly dressed.
You'd stand in line in front of that rail and be inspected to see if your shoes were polished and checked if you had a corset on, so this uniform could be fitted more suitably.
With so much preparation, it's a wonder any student got to chapel on time. In addition to the caps, the pins presented to the first graduates have remained the same, except they're no longer made from $5 gold pieces. A 3-foot bronze replica of that pin, installed in the floor of our new building, welcomes guests and reminds us all that some things never change. In 1906, work began on the school's first official home. Dedicated on January 23, 1908, it was located on the site of today's west wing of the hospital. By 1911, your alumni society, established a few years earlier, was quite active. Class Day, a tradition still, dates to those years when it was held in the basement, with soap boxes arranged as seats of honor. While students did not yet face state boards, seniors were required to pass medical staff exams. In 1912, TCHSN was approved for accreditation by the Board of Regents in the state of New York. By 1916, Ohio had established its own minimum standards for nursing schools, and after June 1, 1918, graduates were required to take the state board exam. Our pass rate ranked in the top 10 schools in the state, and for many years was without a single failing grade. Florence Weisenbach Woolenweber, class of 18, kept a diary of her training at Christ and her concerns. One entry noted, "On the fourth floor OB, poor me. I see where the stork and I will have a fight if he gets too busy." And on April 6, 1917, "President Wilson has declared war. It looks as though we are going to get busy." In 1918, the school had 42 graduates in active military service, 22 of them in the Cincinnati-staffed base hospital unit serving in France. Elsie Schneider, class of 1916, made the military her career, attaining the rank of lieutenant colonel, believed to be the highest rank attained by a TCHSN grad. Here, as elsewhere, the 20s roared in, but there was little time for bathtub gin in the Charleston. We were busy. The Doan House, still standing, was purchased in 1921 as a nurse residence and later housed students during the cadet nurse days of the 40s. The 20s began with the organization of a student government and the first yearbook, Revista. Then in 1922, the Hemostat made its debut. Published monthly and later quarterly, it sold for 25 cents and provided a forum for students. The Glee Club was also founded in the 20s. Students' interest in things musical was demonstrated further by the fund to purchase a piano in 1924. We were busy, what with breakfast at 6:30, chapel at 6:45, and that complicated uniform. With our reputation for excellence already firmly established, the class of 1923 set a state board record. Everyone passed, and 20% scored over 90%, with the highest grade, 95.9%. Maintaining such high standards led to a rise in entrance requirements. In the early 20s, 2 years of high school were required. In 1925, that was increased to 3 years. And the words financial aid appeared when the Red Cross offered 10 $300 scholarships. Although called scholarships, these $300 assists were to be repaid interest-free after graduation. 1928 was a banner year. The first capping ceremony was held and construction began on the nurses' home. Dedicated February 23, 1929, it served temporarily as a hospital with students living on the second floor. In December, when the hospital building was completed and patients were moved out, the building became the school's residence hall exclusively. During the 1920s, alumni raised over $10,000 for an endowed room in the new hospital to be used by any graduate nurse who became ill. Later, the money became the nucleus of the Sick Benefit Fund. The 30s began with a new uniform. Still blue and white, still starched and proper, but much easier to put on and to work in. Students were admonished to wear their watches above the elbow and to never forget their hairnets. As it did the country, the Depression hit the hospital and the school hard. There were salary cuts. Nursing instructors received $50 per month plus room, board, and laundry services. Students were often too poor to buy stamps to write home. In spite of hardship and despite long floor duty, classes, morning chapel, and daily room inspections, the students managed to have fun. In October 1930, the Rio Rita was purchased for student transportation. Harvey Gilbert, the driver, continued in this position for 30 years. 1932 saw tuition raised to $75 per year, including books and uniforms. Long work days and long hospital stays were the norm. With no recovery rooms, patients were taken directly to their rooms after surgery, with a student nurse assigned to sit with them until they woke up. A student commented, "We would be very relieved when that duty was over, since we would be almost sick from the smell of ether." Another nurse recalls, "We had to sharpen needles for hypos and boil syringes. We dissolved codeine and morphine tablets in water in a spoon over a burner." Difficult as the work was, it served as a character builder. During all our days of enemas, back rubs, bedpans, sterilizing our own supplies, and morning chapel services before duty, we were taught that the patient comes first. In the words of Miss Dumb, God bless her, assess his or her needs and meet them with tender, loving care. I was taught to be a responsible person, reliable and caring. Marzetta Schindler-Kohlsdorf, class of 39. When their workday was reduced from 12 to 8 hours, doctors complained that now they had to deal with three nurses instead of two. What inconvenience! The 1937 flood increased hardships. Students remember going upstairs to watch furniture and burning oil tanks float down the river. Because of shortages, water was brought in by the barrelful. Hospital laundry had to be sent to Hamilton, and nurses were limited to one cup of water to rinse a bedpan. Regardless of circumstances, though, the school and the hospital never relaxed their insistence on proper behavior for nurses. Gathering in the drawing room for tea was an opportunity to learn proper etiquette, and proper decorum was strictly enforced. Jeanette Brannon Tooker, class of 37, recalls, "My first day in a white uniform, I was called to the nursing office. At that time, grads were allowed to wear colored hankies in uniform pockets. Two of us had red linen hankies. Miss Christensen told us red was too suggestive." 1940s. The growing popularity of air travel opened a glamorous new career to Christ graduates at a time when only nurses could become airline stewardesses. Christ graduates, among others, took to the friendly skies. World War II brought changes. Even before Pearl Harbor, young graduates were joining the Red Cross nursing services, the only way to get into military service. Enrollments increased, and classes were accepted in January, August, and June. A 1943 bill sponsored by Congresswoman Frances Payne Bolton created the Cadet Corps, which paid student tuition, fees, and some maintenance in exchange for 6 months of military service. Few students rejected this offer, especially with memories of the Depression year so fresh. Sunnyside on Auburn Avenue, purchased in 1921, was reopened as a student residence during the Cadet Corps program. Nearly 125 Christ graduates became part of the military. Cordelia Cook Fillmore, class of 40, followed the Allied invasion from Africa through Italy and into France. The first Army nurse to be twice decorated, she received the Bronze Star and a Purple Heart. Photographer Margaret Bourke White snapped this picture of Betty, as she was known, caring for a soldier despite her own wounded arm. Public health nursing, associated with the Baby's Milk Fund, exposed Christ students, many from rural areas, to the serious social ills of the city. Off they would go into the city each morning, carrying their black doctor bags and wearing their blue uniforms with neckties and sensible shoes. Alice Bone Lamping, class of 49, notes, "Even in a questionably safe neighborhood, we always remembered being told, as long as you are in uniform, you will be safe." Then came the 1950s. Miss Dumm wrote in a letter for the 1953 alumni yearbook, "You could scarcely recognize the nurses' home, for it has been refinished and redecorated from top to bottom. Student rooms, corridors, and even classrooms are painted in gay colors, greens and blues and pinks. The small lounges on the first floor are very modern in appearance." While lounges may have seemed modern, the standards for guarding the virtue of students entertaining their boyfriends were decidedly old-fashioned. Constant supervision, combined with the telephone system, made courtship difficult. Janet Fangmeyer Hyde, class of 54, recalls getting buzzed on the intercom for a phone call. After returning the buzz, you ran up and down the steps to find a vacant phone. But romance apparently found a way, and school rules eased. Several members of our class were among the first to be given permission to marry while training. Finishing classes in May, I married and worked 11 to 7 all summer, graduating in August. We did not get paid, as it was part of our training. Ann Rudolph Peacock, class of 56. Margie Moore, class of 58, remembers the strict adherence to the in your room by 10:30 p.m. rule. The TV would be unceremoniously turned off at 10:30, regardless of who was watching what. Oh well, too much time spent watching television might interfere with basketball practice. In 1958, the white crisscross front was replaced by a solid apron with uniform standards still fairly rigid. Each student was required to have her pair of bandage scissors in the back waistband of the apron between the two ivory stud buttons. Hairnets were required, and the silver student pin was strategically placed to hide any cleavage. There was so much information to master. Anatomy was a particularly difficult class. Instructor Mary Jane Showers required each student to catch her own dissection subject from a vat of live bullfrogs. Miss Matthews provided crucial instruction of another sort. Always stand when a doctor arrives, and don't smoke or wear nail polish while in uniform. The 60s at Christ may not have been as swinging as Woodstock, but with afternoon and night duty limited to 12 weeks and 3 years, our students had time for fun. Linda Francois remembers dances in the rec room, with the house mother calling fraternity houses and inviting boys to come over. Of course, this was the same house mother who strictly enforced the rule that students could not walk through the lobby of the nurse's home in shorts or slacks, and made sure we practiced our manners at the obligatory tea. A highlight of these years were those Christmas dances at Makatiwa. During the 60s, the school offices and all classrooms were moved to the nurse's residence due to construction on the hospital's west wing. The nutrition and science labs were converted to lecture rooms, and the gym became a large assembly room, later known as the Learning Center. And dorm rooms went modern, with carpeting, air conditioning, and new furniture. Those walnut secretaries we'd all love to have now were replaced with more modern oak. Another war, and again, Christ graduates answered the call. Among them, Patricia Hugel Biggs, class of 64, during the Vietnam conflict. As the decade ended, our building was formally rededicated to Isabella Thoburn. ...1973 brought a major change. Men. This coincided with another significant change for female students. Residence in the dorm was no longer required. Regardless, the world did not end, and the school did survive. The male presence did mandate an adaptation of an important school tradition, capping. For the men, the chevron became the symbolic equivalent of our beloved cap, and the ceremony became known as the recognition ceremony. The same year, the uniform changed, and drastically. No more white aprons, light blue, with a mandarin collar, and imagine, just one piece. In response to the demand for trained nurses, under the direction of Director Mary Deegan, the school adopted a 2-year program in order to get nurses into the workplace more quickly. Then, in 1976, a proposed action by the ONA galvanized nurses into action to oppose a resolution that would have mandated that by 1985, every nurse must have a degree. A group known as the Buckeye State Nurses Organization was founded by Mary Deegan and Suzanne Richardson, with our own Melanie Alexander later serving a term as president. The organization worked to promote the interests and continuing education of registered and licensed practical nurses, stressing that all of us have a place in healthcare. Not surprisingly, the proposed resolution never made it to the legislative process, and the school, now lean and focused, continued to educate nurses who were in high demand. The pace of change continued to accelerate. The school uniform was replaced yet again. Like its predecessor, it was light blue, with a white bib, recalling the influence of earlier years. Enrollment soared in the 80s, prompting the school to offer an evening program. Despite the intensification that resulted from compressing the program into 2 years, attrition was at an all-time low. Our students distinguished themselves on state boards, and in a tribute to the school's quality, the National League for Nursing awarded it the maximum, an 8-year accreditation. Our look underwent several changes during this decade. Construction on the hospital's courtyard atrium area resulted in a redo of our entrance, now with two matching flights of three steps parallel to the building. Then there was the adoption of our current uniform. White with blue piping replaced blue with a white bib. At the 1988 capping ceremony, the two classes were clearly differentiated. The 90s saw many changes to the local nursing school scene. Three diploma schools closed their doors. The end of the 20th century found us with few peers. How do we explain our longevity, our survival? One factor is the unflagging support of the organization that gave us birth. The Elizabeth Gamble Deaconess Home Association made a strong statement about the value of our school by its $9.9 million gift of a new building. The association also underwrites our tuition reimbursement program, which provides free tuition in exchange for a two-year work agreement. Also, there is the continuing support of our alumni. Our graduates continue to be our best advertisement, and their generosity through our annual appeal has provided us with many amenities, including our computer center, library, learning assistance program, science lab equipment, and of course, scholarships. But the strongest explanation for our long life also helps to explain the association's support. It is, quite simply, the quality of the education we offer and the nurses we graduate. The 21st century began with talk of moving, leaving our tradition-filled but no longer adequate building. The remarkable result of a collaboration of faculty, staff, and alumni is a new home that combines a state-of-the-art educational facility with a large dose of tradition. Still, our lobby is graced by the Rookwood drinking fountain and brass mailbox, while our drawing room and library almost let you forget we've moved. Our new home debuted with the largest class in our history. 145 incoming students arrived to be educated in the tradition of excellence that is our hallmark. Crucial to our identity, our commitment to excellence remains unchanged. Our reputation, along with our tradition, moved with us. We still wear caps, stress compassion and caring, and educate nurses who enter the workplace buoyed by the achievements of those who preceded them. We congratulate Christ Hospital School of Nursing on an outstanding first century.
Look that guy right in the eye. Oh, we're in the money. Come on, honey.